Welcome back to Natural News from the Field Museum. There's a healthy mix of adorable images and time travel in this episode, and in one story, those two things overlap. Let's start with an update on the love lives of falcons. Peregrine Promiscuity. Sex in the City mentality need not apply to the world's fastest flyers. You won't be seeing them on the Maury Povich show anytime soon. Peregrine Falcons have made a comeback in Illinois over the last few decades thanks to monitoring efforts by field staff and volunteers and ongoing research to see how they're adapting from their traditional cliff-dwelling environments to our city high-rise buildings. We know that these birds mate for life in the wild, but field curator John Bates, collection staffer Mary Hennen, and UIC grad Isabel Caballero were curious to know, since peregrine falcons are in much closer proximity to other breeding pairs here in the city, are they inclined to, go visit the neighbors more often? And their research shows that no, breeding pairs in Chicago remain faithful to one another, same as their rural counterparts. The researchers examined a combination of field observations and DNA testing, looking at small samples of blood taken from baby chicks in order to compare their DNA with their parents, in basically the same way Maury conducts paternity tests on his weekday talk show. DNA testing revealed out of the 35 offspring tested, only one showed the parents cheated. Even so, it's also possible that the male had lost his mate and ended up pairing with a new female who laid eggs that weren't his. Aw, that's kind of cute. The point is, understanding the reproductive behaviors of these falcons enhances our knowledge of how animals can make transitions from rural to urban environments and what sort of impacts our cities have on different species. And on that note, mouse lemurs. Mouse lemur update, the best kind of update. What if I told you mouse lemurs, the world's smallest primates, are actually time machines? To explain, we need to talk about Madagascar, so let's go to our local affiliate, Emily Graslie, who is there right now. Thanks, Emily. So Madagascar's a super unique country. Having been isolated from the rest of Africa has allowed for its species to diversify incredibly, resulting in unique organisms that are found nowhere else. Golly, a lemur! It's also had a lot of variability in its landscapes and geography, but studies show the island was once covered in many more patches of forest. For a long time, nobody was certain how or why the island's geography managed to change so dramatically in the last few thousand years. One argument is that humans were responsible for these shifts in the changing landscape, but the mystery of Madagascar's geographic history has largely gone unsolved. This is Emily Graslie in the rainforest of Madagascar. Back to you!
Thanks, Emily. So this mystery may have finally been solved. A recent study co-authored by Field Museum Research Associate Ann Yoder, field biologist Steve Goodman, and a cohort of collaborators published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences has found that mouse lemurs and their evolution hold the answer. See, mouse lemurs are unique to the island and fast breeding, reaching reproductive maturity within a year. Change, in this case speciation, happens over many generations. So in 50 years, you get 50 generations of mouse lemurs. Additionally, they're dependent on forest environments. If the whole island is a forest, they're free to move anywhere and hang out with all the other mouse lemurs. But removing part of the forest would isolate certain populations from one another, and they're probably not going to be venturing out across open areas to go chill with the mouse lemurs on the other side of the island. The isolation of such groups has resulted in 5 unique species found on Madagascar. Steve and his colleagues examined the DNA from the separate species to pinpoint when the groups became genetically distinct. And it turns out the habitat changes which isolated the mouse lemur groups happened 50,000 years ago, tens of thousands of years before people arrived on the island. This research indicates it has been natural climate changes that affected Madagascar's geography, not to say that humans haven't instigated some impacts too. But by separating out what sort of environmental changes are natural and which are spurred by people helps us understand change over time. And to wrap up this episode of the Natural News, another story about change over time. This one dealing with change over hundreds of millions of years. Starstuff and Nanodiamonds Revisited. There are 2 new publications co-authored by Starstuff and Nanodiamond Protoplanetary Associate Curator Philipp and postdoctoral student Levke Kööp about our collective origins. You may remember him from previous episodes where we discussed the makeup of meteorites. Just like how there are different species or kinds of biological life, meteorites are also grouped together based off of similarities. Philipp's work deals with the carbonaceous chondrites, an ultra-rare group. Only 4.6% of all meteorites that fall on Earth are carbonaceous chondrites, but they hold some of the best clues about the formation of our solar system. That's because these meteorites house what are called calcium aluminum rich inclusions, CAIs, which are tiny light-colored dots within the meteorite. These dots consist of minerals from some of the first solid material that developed out of a gaseous cloud while our solar system was forming, circling around a growing center like a spiral of water heading down a drain, if the drain was our future sun. By studying these CAIs, we can determine what type of exploding stars and events contributed to the formation of our own solar system and improve our understanding of the different stages of its evolution. After examining the makeup of these CAIs, Philipp and his colleagues report that they contain a wide range of different minerals, suggesting that our solar system inherited material from a number of stars when it was forming, meaning our solar system could have resulted from a rare supernova event, type 1A, where two stars orbit one another and eventually explode. And to think, all of this awesome knowledge from looking at a meteorite. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Natural News from the Field Museum, and thanks to everybody who called in the hotline number for the film reel for the prehistoric workout. While we don't actually have one of those for you, we do have merch from dftba.com, and we're going to send some of those callers some of the merch just to say thanks for calling in and for watching. So make sure you guys subscribe so you can get updates every time we post a new video, and stay tuned for the next episode in 2 weeks.